we will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to take the law, we enforce it. But at the end of the day, each and every man has to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. I'm your host, Dave Bourne, and it is May 17th, 2016, and I'm coming to you live from Las Vegas, Nevada. Thank you for tuning in to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. We're on weeknights, Tuesday through Thursday, usually at 7 o'clock, but today we are on at a special time of 6:30. Usually 10 o'clock Eastern, but that would be 9:30 Eastern. And you can listen live on Spreaker.com and NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com and to the archives immediately following the show on Spreaker, YouTube, Twitter, and SoundCloud, as well as the next day on Stitcher. On Nonpartisan Liberty for All, we promote the ideas of true freedom and liberty and self-ownership, meaning being able to do whatever you want as long as you respect the freedom of others and don't directly interfere with their freedom, exposing government for what it is, a mafia based on extortion that rules without consent by threat of force and violence. And we are happy to hear from you, and you can reach us via phone at 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664. Or via Skype, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All. Just send a Skype friend request and your name and what you want to talk about, and we will get you on the air. And you can check us out at NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com, which has links to all of our social media information, Facebook, Twitter, etc., as well as contact information and more. And if you missed the number or the Skype username, you can find it all there at NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. In the beginning of the show, in the very beginning, I always play my intro that I've pretty much been playing, at least the song part of it, since the beginning. I think maybe a couple shows I might have played something different, but I didn't add the voice commentary or the clips that I added there till later. But they've been there a while now, and I've still been meaning to kind of clean that up and improve it, which I actually started working on some stuff this weekend and didn't finish it. So, but anyway, that's one of the things I need to work on. But the point being that some of those attitudes, now, I think they've always existed. I think the police have always been how they are now, for the most part, as far as getting away with the things they do and killing people and beating them and abusing them and harassing them. It was just more, I think, hidden than it is now, where everybody has a camera, and maybe people would have been more outraged years ago than they are now, at least I hope. But I think one of the things that helped contribute to that is what we're going to talk about tonight, and that's the drug war. Now, we've talked about the drug war before. We've actually talked about it plenty of times and did a whole show on it before. So I'm not looking to rehash any of the past shows where I spoke about the drug war. What I'm looking to do is let everybody know how the drug war affects them and they don't even realize it. So how it affects people that don't even use drugs. And that is in, I think, so many different ways. It ain't even funny. And it's something that people don't think about. They just think about things are the way they are. And that's how it is. But, of course, it's hard to do that without getting into the drug war a little itself. So, of course, we'll talk a little about what we've talked about before regarding the drug war and some of the stuff that we haven't talked about. But just to, of course, give a background and contribute to what we're talking about. But the main focus tonight is how the drug war affects people and they don't even realize it. And they're not drug users. And even people that have never done drugs in their life, never even tried any drugs. I remember the only drug I've really done is marijuana. And the last time I did that was, geez, a long time ago. I've mentioned this before. And I didn't like it. I don't have anything against it. Of course, I think all drugs should be decriminalized. And when I say decriminalized, I like what Daryl Perry said when Daryl Perry's running, or Daryl W. Perry, because there's a lot of Daryl Perrys, is from Free Talk Live. He's running for president of the Libertarian Party, and he was on the show a few weeks ago, maybe a month ago. And he thinks drugs should be treated like tomatoes. And I agree with him. Actually, I'd probably take it even, you know, not even take it that far, because tomatoes, I believe, are inspected by the FDA, at least organic ones. But I don't know what the process is on vegetables. And, of course, it matters whether they're being imported or not. I would have private companies, and we're actually planning on talking about this tomorrow. This may change, but we're planning on talking about government agencies tomorrow and how all the things that government agencies do can be done privately. And I just want to make something clear as well. When I say privately, I'm not talking about taxpayer money privately. And that's a huge difference. And people don't realize how huge a difference that is. Like I saw John Stossel one time on his show talk about trash pickup being done privately. But he was talking about taking, really outsourcing is what he was talking about, not privately. So what he was talking about was taking the taxpayer money and paying a private company as opposed to having a government or government employees or a government company, something along those lines, where they report to the government. They're considered government employees, as opposed to outsourcing. So, like, that's what they're doing with prisons there. And we'll talk a little about this in the show today. They outsource prisons. They do not have private, they call them private prisons, but they're not private prisons. They're outsourced prisons, meaning that the tax money that would be paid to a government prison, a prison that is run by the government with all government employees, they're just taking that money and using it for a private prison, or they're making some deal where maybe it's less money. Either way, it's taxpayer money. It's extorted money. So when I'm talking about making something private, I'm talking about there's no taxpayer money. it's people pay their own money or they don't pay at all or it doesn't exist. So I guess there's three kind of scenarios there. It doesn't exist, which in a lot of ways is a positive thing, because a lot of these programs that they have only exist because the government does whatever they want with your money, not what you would want them to do with your money. Or you pay, instead of paying taxes, you would pay for that service. Or you don't pay for that service and you don't get it. Or I guess a fourth one would be, and this is what they do in Detroit with the Detroit Threat Management Center, where they do practice a lot of what a lawyer would call pro bono work, and they do a lot of work for free for the people that they know can't afford it. And I think the same thing would happen. I know that people love to say that, no, that wouldn't work, and all the poor people would get stuck without all these things, like school. Well, school, if you homeschool, you take care of that right there anyway. Or if you, you know, do favors babysitting for people and then they, you know, they do the schooling, you babysit on the weekend, you know, you do favors. But regardless of what people like to put out there, I believe with no taxes that more people, I mean, you already have all these charities as it is with all the taxes that people pay. You have so many charities out there, and that's downplayed in the media. And I know a lot of them are religious, but they don't necessarily say that if you are not religious that they won't help you. So it's not as if the religious charities don't help people that are not religious, but there are not just religious charities. And again, everybody knows that, oh, the government will take care of it, so they don't bother. Plus, they're already paying for it, so why pay twice? If they weren't paying any taxes, then it's like, hey, I'm going to pay some of this money that I have and help whatever charity you want to help. And you'll have a little extra money because you won't be getting taxes out. In my case, it would have been $20,000 extra that I would have had last year. Now, I wouldn't have donated $20,000. You know, I'm not going to sit here and lie and say, oh, yeah, that $20,000 would have went to charity. Some of it would have went to insurance, of course, and unemployment insurance, because that wouldn't, well, it might have still been, unemployment insurance might have been a benefit of work, since if it didn't exist via the government, it might have still been a benefit. So there might have been more benefits through work. So I would have saved some of that money, but I probably would have donated some of it. The problem is I don't know what charities to trust. I would rather just fucking give money to a family, really, and just help them that way. Somebody that I know needs help. And that's really how you'd weed out all the people that are abusing the system anyway. But that's really a whole nother show. What we're going to talk about tonight is are the effects of the drug war that really don't have anything to do with drugs, or not that they don't have anything to do with drugs. I mean, obviously they all have something to do with drugs and the drug war, but they're more causes or more things that people don't think about or realize that are effects of the drug war or consequences of the drug war. You know, again, most people think that, okay, well, if, as long as I don't do drugs, the drug war is not going to affect me. And of course, that's total fucking bullshit. Total bullshit. And it's obvious if you really think about it. Now, I'm not saying that people aren't, I mean, when I say most people aren't aware, it's more I'm saying that most people don't think about it. And maybe most people aren't aware. I don't know. But it might be something that people are aware if they think about it. But do they really even think about it? If they're not somebody who is, say, pro-legalization or decriminalization or tomatoization, then it might not be something that they even think about. But people have been so... One of the things about the drug war that I've realized, especially being a kid, like a little kid in the 80s and parts of the 80s, of course, it's a whole decade, and seeing all this stuff and thinking how bad drugs were, like how they tried to make you think how bad they were, and not only from a standpoint of using them, but how bad a person you were if you sold drugs or you were a drug dealer. And then they had that other thing, which never went over because it was such bullshit, was the trying to push drugs on people. They'd always have the commercials and the after-school specials of the drug dealer trying to push, you know, give a free sample and get somebody hooked on their drugs, which I've been around a lot of people that have done drugs. And, you know, one of my best friends has done like every drug there is. And yeah, he wanted me to do drugs with him, not so he could sell them to me because he wasn't selling them, because he wanted somebody to do them with, just like drinking, that people don't want to drink alone, even though alcohol to me is one of the I would say that there are drugs that are just as bad, but there are none that are worse. I would say there are drugs that are equally bad. Now, not doing any of these other drugs, it's hard for me to say, but you know, I've had prescription drugs before, but besides that, I've never, you know, took anything on the, you know, the street, the heroin or cocaine or what's that drug that the rate ecstasy or whatever they're calling it now is Molly ecstasy or no, it's MDMA, whatever. Just none of that for whatever reason. It was just something that I had chose like, no, I'm not going to fuck with that. I drank a lot. We'll put it that way. So alcohol was really, I guess, my, you know, and I sit there and say, well, I haven't really done much because I didn't do all these drugs, but I drank a lot at times, and I think of it totally differently. But it's, to me, it's just as bad as all these other drugs. So it's like what I was doing was just as bad as what people that were doing heroin were probably doing. But I didn't think of it that way because it's just perception, and it was more respectable. And one of the reasons why alcohol is more respectable, I mean, there's a lot of reasons, but one of them is because it's a drink where you're not taking a needle. If all these other drugs were drinks, things might be a lot different. Like drinking and even smoking isn't considered that bad. And then you get to pills, and pills are, you know, semi, but people take pills for, you know, a lot of things. So it's not as bad. But when you get into smoking things out of glass pipes and shooting things up, that's when the perception, it gets pretty bad. And again, that doesn't mean that it's worse, although it does seem to be, but that's where the perception seems to get worse. And then going back to alcohol, you're having a drink, and the perception of drinking a liquid isn't as bad as the perception of, you know, shooting something or snorting something as well. Because everybody drinks something. I'm not saying alcohol, but everybody drinks liquids. Most people take pills, whether it's, you know, aspirin or you get a cold or whatever. A lot of people smoke cigarettes, which is another drug that is probably, I mean, cigarettes and alcohol have killed more people than probably all other drugs combined. And alcohol poisoning is something that they don't seem to talk a lot about it. I mean, it comes up now and then at college campuses, but a lot of people have died from alcohol poisoning. My cousin actually got alcohol poisoning and almost died. So, you know, alcohol, the only positive about alcohol is that it's really hard to get addicted to. Like, actually, because alcohol, you can get physically addicted to alcohol. I mean, it's a horrible drug, really. But to get physically addicted, it takes you a while. I mean, you got to be probably drinking like every fucking day, getting wasted, like drinking all day. I mean, I don't know. Because I never really, I was more of a binge drinker where I drink, you know, I wouldn't drink for a while. And then when I did drink, I would just drink a lot. Like on the weekends, I'd, you know, drink a lot or something. And I went through periods where, you know, I did drink, but they wouldn't last long. You know, I didn't go through periods of, like, I never drank a whole month straight or something. Maybe a couple weeks, but that would probably be the most. So, and plus, the other positive thing about alcohol, it's also it's a negative thing, depending on how you look at it, is the hangovers can get really bad, which makes you at least stop for a little while, no matter what. So, but I really do view alcohol as one of the worst drugs out there, but people just accept it. And I'm not saying that alcohol should be banned. My point is that if alcohol is illegal and it's worse than a lot of these drugs, especially marijuana, why shouldn't all the other drugs be legal? So people have just been so indoctrinated, like I said, especially in the 80s, and it continues now. And now what you have is a result of the drug war. One of the things, and we'll get into how it has affected freedoms, and it has really affected freedoms to the point where it's up there. If I were to list things that would increase the amount of freedom, drugs would be right up there. It's one of the most important things, I believe, in increasing the amount of freedom that people have. And most of it has nothing to do with the actual drug itself, with the taking of the drug. It's everything else that has been done as a result of it. So we're going to get into all of that, but they just, in the 80s and now, and oh, what I was going into is you get all these other drugs too. And I don't know that this is specifically a freedom thing, but it is a result of the drug war, which I'm going to get into also, not just things that are results of the attack on freedom, but also that are just results of the drug war that don't directly have to do with the drug. But things like, I guess they call them bath salts or synthetic marijuana or drugs that people are making in their house now. Most of these drugs, in my opinion, would not exist if it wasn't for the fact that they made it harder to get other drugs. So even though you can get other drugs or more expensive, people have created cheaper ways and easier ways where instead of going out and, you know, looking for cocaine or something, you know, they created meth and people can make meth in their house. And it's not that easy. I mean, I watch Breaking Bad like everybody else. It's not like when I say you can make it in your house, it's not like it's that easy. But at the same time, you don't have to rely on somebody to import something from South America neither. So it created, the demand is always going to be there. That's the whole thing. And that's what most people will never understand is unless you eliminate the demand, and the only way you can do that is somehow, I don't think you'd ever do it, but if you want to eliminate demand, it's not by laws, it's not by banning anything, it's by talking to people and eliminating the need for drugs. And I don't think it really matters because you look at alcohol and you can put it up there with everything else. I don't think it really matters how good your life is or how stable, mentally stable you are. I think there's always going to be casual users of things. It's the addicts that I think you can help to prevent because it's not the drug that's the problem. It's whatever's behind it. People do drugs not because of just the drug itself. It's because they have other issues, especially people that get addicted to them. Now, people that just, you say, well, they come home and have a couple beers. Well, they could come home and have weed or have some other drug as well, as long as they don't go to the point where it's like destroying their lives. Then, you know, it's just to relax them or, you know, maybe they had a stressful day or whatever. I don't think it's a big deal. And that demand, I don't think you're ever going to eliminate. Now, the more together people, the more people that grow up more in stable environments, I think there would be less of a want for drugs. Now, that doesn't mean everybody who grows up nice and has a great life is going to never do drugs. I'm just saying there's less. I think that would cut down the amount of people that actually did drugs. And that's another thing that I don't look at for that reason, but peaceful parenting and radical unschooling, that's more for freedom's sake than anything else. But I think at the same time, you create more stable people that might not see a need for drugs. They might be a casual user, but they won't be doing drugs to deal with some other issue or some other problem, because that's addicts, that's really where it comes from. It's because they have other issues. If you're an addict of anything, if you're a gambling addict, if you're a, well, maybe not a coffee addict, but maybe, I don't know. But if you're addicted to playing video games all the time, I mean, you're missing something. You know, maybe if you take kids that play video games all the time and that's all they do, and maybe they don't have any friends or they don't have a relationship with family, or they, I mean, the majority, you could say maybe the majority of them. And I'm talking about people that play, you know, there was a guy who died because he wouldn't get out of his chair. Because they get that excitement that they're not getting in any other aspect of their life. So it's not just drugs. Drugs just happen to be more physically harmful than other things. But it's not getting to the root of the problem. But, of course, the government doesn't give a fuck about the root of the problem. They care about money. They care about these big budgets. And they care about getting elected. So before I get to what I believe in the drug war, it decreases freedom for non-drug users. I've talked about this recently, because when I talked about Prince, I focused on opiates, but the path for drugs getting banned and the DEA going after them and things like that are all pretty similar. But just a summary, of course, that, and we'll go, you know, right to the 70s, that Nixon, you know, reinvented the war on drugs, which really started, depending on the drug, you know, opium was 1914 and cocaine was, I'm not sure of the year, but, you know, back then as well. And marijuana, I think, was 1937, you know, probably between the 20s and the 40s was where all these drugs got banned in some sort of some capacity, one way or another. So a lot of cops will tell you, at least from, and I watched a lot of documentaries where they interviewed so many former police officers, and occasionally you'll see current ones, and I might play an interview from a current officer. Usually they won't speak out because they're too scared to, and he just doesn't give a fuck. He's like, whatever, I'm not going to, you know. But I think he still arrests people for drugs, and that's the problem. He did say, okay, if I have a call, a drug call and another call, I'll go to the other call. And he had, I don't know if it was him or somebody else. I think it might have been him, but it could have been somebody else that had said, but I think it was him, that they were scared and thought they just OD'd on cocaine. And they were so fucked up, you know, they went to a cop and said that. And he just took them to the hospital and that was it. And you usually won't see that, but you have a lot of former officers saying that the drug war is just ridiculous. It's pointless. It's a waste of money and all these things. Now, that doesn't mean that these people support freedom. And we'll talk about that group, LEAP, law enforcement officers against prohibition. I think the majority of them, though, are former officers, because if you start saying that shit while you're a cop, then you don't have much of a future. But I did find one in one video who is currently a cop and did come out and say, hey, look, I think this is bullshit. And said that a lot of other cops think it's bullshit too, but they're too scared to say anything. So anyway, Nixon in the 70s, of course, and had kind of reinvented the war on drugs. And I should have wrote down the line because now I totally forget it, that the biggest enemy of the American people or something along those lines, the biggest threat was drugs, of course. Right. I don't know what the percentage of users there were there, but I seriously doubt it was the worst or biggest threat to public enemy number one. That's what he had said. Public enemy number one was drugs. Right. Not probably cholesterol was probably worse. Hamburgers or something or McDonald's. But he had, and I had learned this from the show I did on Prince and Opiates, that his rationale really, I don't know if he really believed that or not. He may have, but according to, I don't recall the source, but it was the Vietnam War. It was the troops using drugs that got him all flustered with this is the biggest, the number one public enemy number one, because he started thinking about, well, fuck, our troops are out there getting high on all these drugs and we got to do something about that. I don't know what banning drugs in the U.S. is going to do to troops and troops access in Vietnam, but whatever. That's what it, maybe it was when they came back, and just to send a message as well at the same time. But what I had heard was, along with that, that they had to be drug tested and they wouldn't let them leave until they were clean. And so Nixon did what he did, of course, with Watergate, resigned. He's gone. And Reagan later, because I think Nixon resigned in, 74, I believe. And I know Carter was elected in, maybe it was 73. But it wasn't, it was about 10 years because Reagan didn't get into office until 81. It was about 10 years or so till Reagan really brought the drug war back up and just totally put it on steroids. I mean, when it comes to the war on drugs, there is nobody that did more damage than Ronald Reagan. And I've mentioned this before, and he's so praised by the Republicans because the majority of them are anti-drug. Of course, they're for freedom. You can't be anti-drug and for freedom. You can't. So to all you Republicans out there that think drugs should be legal, you cannot believe in freedom. Because you can't believe in freedom and believe in self-ownership. And if you believe in self-ownership, you believe that you can put whatever you want in your body. As I had mentioned, opium was the first thing in 140 years of the country that the government had came out and said that you can't put this in your body anymore. So before that, the government had never said that, had never came out and told people what they could put in their body. So that's why I call Republicans total hypocrites when they talk about freedom and liberty. Of course, Democrats are hypocrites as well. But when it comes to this, not only that is they damage the words freedom and liberty because they push people that would be supportive of true freedom and liberty away. Because when the mainstream, or I don't want to say mainstream people, but just the average person hears it, they think of Republicans and, you know, the freedom and liberty, because that's what they talk about, even though they don't stand for it. Because one of the biggest, again, the biggest things when it comes to freedom and liberty, obviously, is owning your own body and having the ability to put what you want in it and do what you want with it as well. So if you don't believe in legalized prostitution, it's the same difference. And probably a lot of them even do. They just, you know, they go to prostitutes and then, but then they arrest other people. So Reagan did so much damage with his propaganda. I mean, it was a big propaganda campaign. They started DARE, which I don't even know what the fuck it stands for anymore. I just know the D, I think drugs, D-A-R-E, obviously DARE, drug awareness. I don't even know what the R and the E is for. I just know it was an acronym called DARE that Reagan started, and he had cops going to schools talking. I mean, and the shit that they were saying was just, it was just total lies too. They weren't even honest about it. It's like, okay, if you wanted people to stop or not do drugs, I mean, they were honest about the fact, I think, that you're going to go to fucking jail, but they were just so, you know, dishonest about how bad these people were and what drugs did to you, and depending on what drug it was. And they just put out so much fucking propaganda, it wasn't even funny. Reagan had even said, and there's a quote of him saying this, that you could see it on video, is what I mean, that cannabis is the most dangerous drug in the U.S. And of course, the gateway propaganda that they had made up. Oh, well, maybe it's not as bad, but it's a gateway drug, because if you start smoking marijuana, you know, you're going to be smoking crack pretty soon, which, whether you want to think it's a conspiracy or not, it was the U.S. government bringing in all of this cocaine and essentially starting the crack epidemic in L.A. that spread all over the country. And I did a paper on crack and cocaine, and I should have just talked to people that did it, but from what I understand, crack, I believe, got you high 10 minutes and cocaine 15 minutes. I don't even understand the purpose of it. But what it did was with crack, you know, they'd mix it up and they could sell it for a lot. You know, coke was more of the high-priced, not millionaire drug, but more of the, you know, Wall Street did a lot of coke, and in the 80s, I know it was more the higher class drug, because I know at one point it was $50 a gram, not because I bought coke, but I had looked into selling it at one point when I was younger, and that's, you know, expensive for shit that gets you high for, I mean, I don't know how many lines are in a gram. I think like 3 or 4, and shit that gets you high for, you know, an hour or something, I guess, if you did the whole bag. But they essentially, the government, are not only responsible for crack, but I mean, they were bringing in tons of cocaine. Now they're bringing in opium. And I don't have, to be honest, a problem. Well, I have a problem with the government being involved in business, but I don't have a problem with cocaine or opium being brought in to the country or cannabis or any of that. The problem I have is the government making money off it and being hypocrites and putting all these people in jail for it. And we'll get to that as well. So what I'm going to do is take a break. And then when we come back, I'm going to get into all the freedoms that have been destroyed, really, by the drug war. You know, including things like, you know, phone tapping, illegal phone tapping, and we'll talk about that because data is being passed between agencies. So we will be right back after this. If you'd like to call in, 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664. You can also Skype in username Nonpartisan Liberty for All and check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. We'll be right back.
Over 40 years ago, U.S. President Richard Nixon declared drug abuse public enemy number one, starting an unprecedented global campaign, the War on Drugs. Today, the numbers are in. The War on Drugs is a huge failure with devastating unintended consequences. It led to mass incarceration in the U.S., to corruption, political destabilization and violence in Latin America, Asia and Africa, to systemic human rights abuses across the world. It negatively affected the lives of millions of people. All of this while we waste billions of dollars every year only to create and fuel powerful drug cartels, while the goal of the war on drugs seems less achievable than ever. A world without drugs. How could this happen? The core strategy of the war on drugs is no drugs, no problems. So almost all of the efforts in the last few decades have been focused on eradicating the supply of drugs and incarcerating drug traffickers. But this ignores the most fundamental of market forces, supply and demand. If you reduce the supply of anything without reducing the demand first, its price goes up. This might lower sales for many products, but not for drugs. The drugs market is not price sensitive. Drugs will be consumed no matter what they cost. So the effect is to encourage production of more drugs and recruitment of more traffickers, which increases availability. This is also known as the balloon effect. Even if drug production or a major supply route is destroyed, the supply for the end user is not reduced. A perfect example of this is crystal meth. The US government tried to stop its production by strictly regulating the sale of chemicals used to manufacture the drug. This forced big meth producers out of business, but the unintended consequences were that thousands of small-scale operations started all over the country, mostly in small towns and rural communities, using chemicals that weren't regulated. In response to this, some US states wanted to reduce the supply of homegrown meth by regulating even more chemicals, which reduced small-scale meth production drastically. But the supply of meth still stayed the same. Mexican drug cartels immediately took over and opened big production operations. Their meth was even better than it was before, and they had loads of experience in smuggling. So all these efforts made meth production more professional, the drug more potent, while supply wasn't reduced at all. You can't win this war on the supply side. Not only are drugs widely available, demand unbroken, and some drugs purer than in the past, with a budget of around $30 billion, the U.S. Drug Enforcement Agency has an efficiency rate of less than 1% when it comes to stopping the flow of drugs into the U.S. and inside the U.S. For many minors around the world, it's as easy to get illegal drugs as alcohol. But it doesn't stop here. Prohibition may prevent a certain amount of people from taking drugs, but in the process, it causes huge damage to society as a whole. Many of the problems we associate with drug use are actually caused by the war against them. For example, prohibition makes drugs stronger. The more potent drugs you can store in as little space as possible, the more profit you'll make. It was the same during alcohol prohibition, which led to an increased consumption of strong liquor over beer. The prohibition of drugs also led to more violence and murders around the world. Gangs and cartels have no access to the legal system to settle disputes, so they use violence. This led to an ever-increasing spiral of brutality. According to some estimates, the homicide rate in the US is 25 to 75% higher because of the war on drugs. And in Mexico, a country on the front line, an estimated 164,000 have been murdered between 2007 and 2014. More people than in the war zones of Afghanistan and Iraq in the same period combined. But where the war on drugs might do the most damage to society is the incarceration of non-violent drug offenders. For example, the United States, one of the driving forces of the war on drugs, has 5% of the world's total population, but 25% of the world's prison population, largely due to the harsh punishments and mandatory minimums. Minorities suffer because of this especially. African Americans make up 40% of all US prison inmates. And while white kids are more likely to abuse drugs, black kids are 10 times more likely to get arrested for drug offenses. Okay, but is there actually something different we can do? Is there a way out of this mess? In the 1980s, Switzerland experienced a public health crisis related to heroin use. HIV rates skyrocketed and street crime became a problem. Swiss authorities tried a new strategy, harm reduction. They opened free heroin maintenance centers where addicts would be treated and stabilized. Here, people would be given free heroin of high quality, they would get clean needles and have access to safe injection rooms, showers, beds and medical supervision. Social workers helped them find housing and deal with other problems in their lives. The results were a sharp drop in drug-related crime, and two-thirds of the people in the centers got regular jobs because now they could focus on getting better instead of financing their addiction. Today, over 70% of all heroin addicts in Switzerland receive treatment. HIV infections have dropped drastically. Deaths from heroin overdoses have dropped by 50%. And drug-related street sex work and crime has been reduced enormously. So there are methods that are not only way cheaper, but also actually work instead of creating more problems. Drug prohibition led to a system that bulldozes human rights, costs vast sums of money, and creates a lot of human misery, all in pursuit of an unobtainable goal. After 40 years of fighting, it's time to finally end the war on drugs and move on to something better. This video was supported by the Open Society Foundations and by viewer donations on Patreon. If you want to learn more about how you can influence drug policy, check out the Stop the Harm campaign. We finally have some merchandise. If you want your own Kurzgesagt poster, t-shirt, mug or stickers of little monsters, you can get them now at the DFTBA store.
Prohibitions do not eliminate the market for illicit goods. Prohibitions do, however, increase violence and increase the risk of overdose. The recent history of the United States includes two major periods of prohibition, federal alcohol prohibition from 1920 to 1933, and the current war on drugs, which began in 1971. During both of these periods, we witnessed increases in the homicide death rate that correspond to enforcement of these prohibitions. Why do prohibitions lead to violence? First, we have to recognize that prohibiting the production or consumption of a substance does not eliminate its use. Almost half of high school seniors report using an illegal substance in their life. Prohibition merely drives the market for drugs underground. Producers operate in a black market, and consumers conceal their behavior. Economics predicts a variety of adverse effects of black markets. The evidence confirms these effects. In a black market, when disputes arise over sales territory, over product quality, over correct change, the legal system is not available. Drug producers and consumers must resolve their own disputes and may rely on violence to do so. The underground nature of black markets has other negative effects. Consumers can't report their drug dealers to the Better Business Bureau for having sold them low-quality cocaine. The lack of legal, visible options to impugn the reputation of bad faith drug dealers typically leads to lower quality and, importantly, less predictable quality drugs, increasing the risk of poisoning and of overdose. Further, law enforcement expends resources to enforce prohibitions. The time that police officers spend chasing drug dealers and users is time not spent catching murderers, thieves, or rapists. Prison space used to house drug dealers and users is space not available for other more serious criminals. One estimate suggests that homicide rates are 25 to 75% higher than they would be in the absence of drug prohibition. If your goal is to reduce the consumption of marijuana, cocaine, meth, or heroin, there are other policy choices available. A policy regime such as the one we have with tobacco, with high tax rates, minimum smoking ages, and extensive education campaign, could keep the consumption of these drugs relatively low while avoiding the violence and quality issues associated with a black market. It might seem counterintuitive that prohibitions are not the most effective way to reduce the consumption of a good, but economics points out that prohibitions generate black markets, and black markets lead to other adverse effects.
Promoting the ideas of true freedom and liberty, Nonpartisan Liberty for All Radio with Dave Bourne.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and we are back. Again, if you'd like to call in, 702-470-7664. And if you'd like to Skype in, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and you can get all that information at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. So before the break, I had mentioned going into the items or different things that I believe decreases or at least attacks our level of freedom. It's not going to give full freedom or true freedom or anything like that, but there are, of course, levels of freedoms. We can look at different states, we can look at different countries, and we can see how in different places, although you don't have total freedom or what I define as true freedom anywhere, you do have different levels of freedom where you might be in, like, one state, for example, Nevada, in my opinion, has a lot more freedom than California. But Nevada still does not have, I wouldn't call it a place that has freedom. Or, you know, some other country that has less freedom than, say, the United States. Although the United States is getting pretty high up there or pretty low, depending on how you want to look at it, when it comes to freedom, because they are continuing to take more and more freedoms away. But part one of the things that allowed them to do this, and I don't even know, for all I know, Reagan going after drugs could have been something that was a planned thing to take more freedom away. Because, again, this is something I believe that started pretty much right after the country started. And ever since, there's been an attack on freedom. I don't believe the Constitution gave true freedom and liberty. I think it gave a level of freedom. And it only gave a level of freedom to certain people. It didn't give it to women. It didn't give it to black people. It didn't give it in general. It didn't give what I would call true freedom and liberty anyway. And we were just talking about this on Friday. And it also is flawed in that it's a piece of paper. You can't enforce a piece of paper magically, and you can't, when you're trying to supposedly give power to the people and make it the people's government, you cannot do that with some fucking document, especially when government is supported by a bunch of men with guns. And no matter what you say in your document or how free your document is, it's not going to matter because the people that you give power over you are going to continue to take more power. And that's what has happened. Obviously, the Constitution has failed. But the Constitution, even in its current form, not only do you have issues with interpretations, added amendments, changes as interpretations, it never gave true freedom and liberty in any form, anyway, in any way you want to take it, really. So first, the biggest thing that it took freedom away, or the biggest way, I guess, I said the biggest thing that took freedom away, or the biggest way it took away freedom, was the police and the government agencies, law enforcement agencies. So law enforcement is the biggest way that the drug war violated people's freedoms. Now, I know you could say, well, if you didn't do anything, it didn't matter. Well, that's not really true, because take something like a traffic stop. Now, plenty of people either go through random checkpoints, which there are more and more of, and they're not just for alcohol. Unfortunately, there are I think it was in Ohio, where they have license checkpoints where they check, which is totally illegal. They have immigrant checkpoints now, which the Supreme Court has ruled is legal. It's getting pretty ridiculous, in my opinion, and how far they're going. But really what all these are is drug. It's all related to drugs. And if you think about it, in a traffic stop, you know, they ask you all these questions. They'll ask you where you're coming from, where you're going. You don't have to answer any of them, and I suggest you don't. And you just say, look, I don't answer questions, or I'm exercising my Fifth Amendment right. But the fact that drugs are illegal is one of the things that contributes heavily to traffic stops and the way they act during traffic stops. Now, if drugs were totally decriminalized, do I think traffic stops would end? No, because there's another reason for traffic stops, and that's obviously to make money. There's no doubt in my mind that they care about making the money too. It's not just about keeping people in control or keeping people under control and searching their vehicles and things like that and looking for drugs. They want the money too. So don't get me wrong that a lot of traffic stops, it's about the money. So yes, traffic stops would still happen. Now, would you get your car searched illegally? That would probably drop 90-something percent, because what the fuck are they looking for? If you got rid or if you decriminalized drugs in the way that I explained, the Darrell W. Perry tomato theory, even in that way, where, yes, they had to go through like the FDA or something, we'll even use that scenario. The way I look at it is they're just products that are out there and you can buy them and there's no FDA and none of that shit. But there would be private companies that would inspect these things and things like that and whatever. But we'll just base it upon the current structure just for the fuck of it. So even with that, it being the equivalent of a tomato, they're not, I think traffic stops would be reduced right away, because if they're not going to give you a ticket, if they were planning on giving you a warning, or they were planning on pulling you over to fuck with you, or Well, it might not necessarily eliminate fucking with you, but they're definitely not going to pull you over because they think you have drugs in your car. Because it doesn't matter. So what would they be searching for? Nothing. So first of all, when it comes to your freedom on the road and the freedom to travel, drugs being legal or decriminalized would have a huge effect on that. Because what they would be, their only purpose really would be money, revenue to collect money from tickets. Now you could say you still have terrorism and they could start to use that, which is true. However, that wouldn't of covered the past, you know, 20, 30 years, maybe the past 10, but during the 80s or during the 70s or 90s or before 9/11, it wouldn't have been a concern of the police. So you have that, and you have all these people that got pulled over because maybe they were in a certain kind of car, or maybe because of the race they were, or maybe that they thought they might have drugs. There were two women, and I've mentioned this a bunch of times, but I will continue to mention this for people who haven't heard it, that both orifices were searched on both of them. With one glove, the woman didn't change the glove on the side of the road because they claimed that they smelled marijuana in the car. So what did they do? They searched the car. No marijuana. They searched them. No marijuana or cannabis, as it should be called. So they said, we're going to give you a cavity search. Now, they could have refused, I believe. I don't think they had any warrant or anything like that, but they were so scared. I mean, there's the intimidation factor. And cops will tell you, well, they could have said no, or, you know, about searching your car. When someone has a gun pointed at you, or they have a gun on a holster, that's like me asking somebody for money, you know, open carrying. And going over to somebody and asking them for money that they owe me. I think they're more apt to give it to me than if I didn't have that. So there's, and never mind that. I mean, they're police that obviously they, they it can intimidate you in more ways than just, you know, having a gun. You know, they can arrest you. They can harass you. They can harass you in the future. So you're in a situation. You're scared. These women obviously didn't deal with the haven't dealt with the police before. And, you know, so I don't blame them. But what was that based on? That was based on they said, oh, I smell marijuana. A girl recently, and I actually heard this on Glenn Beck, I think was either suspended or expelled from school because they smelled her fingers. And she said that it was nothing. They said, oh, it's marijuana. How can you use what... You know, I swear at work, I walk by this one office and I swear it smells like marijuana. I walked by somebody today when I was going to the parking lot. It doesn't matter because where I work, we'll just say there's a part where people that don't work there can go so they can do whatever they want. But the office part is fucked up, but I don't think that's what they're doing. But how can you just base it off of that? I believe she even took a drug test and passed. and they still suspended her or expelled her or something like that. So to do that is crazy. But they've done that before. This other guy, who I think he ended up getting millions, they pulled him over. They said he was clenching his butt in a certain way, and I guess he's been arrested for drugs before. So they brought him to one hospital, wanted them to give him like an anal cavity search. That hospital refused. They brought him to another hospital, and they gave him an enema. They did all this stuff. Disgusting stuff that we're not even going to get into, to search his butt for drugs. Of course, nothing was there. So look how these are just two examples of how these people have had their rights violated and their freedoms violated over drugs being a criminal offense. Marijuana specifically, not even anything, well, at least in the first case. I don't recall in the second case, I know it was in New Mexico, what drugs they suspected he had. But that's not probable. I mean, it's just bullshit. They can do whatever the fuck they want, essentially. But they can't do whatever they want if they're searching for something that is not illegal. So they can't search your car. They can't search your person. They can't do any of this stuff. If, you know, they can do it now because drugs are illegal. So they can use that against anybody. You don't have to be a drug user. They could say they smell marijuana. They could say that they think you have drugs in your car, that a dog hit on your car when they didn't, and they can rip your car apart. They can get a rubber stamp on a warrant. This is another thing now, that the Fourth Amendment might as well not exist. For people who aren't familiar with the Fourth Amendment, it's search and seizure, that you need a warrant, and judges just pretty much rubber stamp warrants. So they could search your house for drugs, and they can rip your house apart based on nothing. I mean, some crackhead who, and I've heard this before, they have these informants that are literally crackheads that will pay money and say that, you know, oh, these people have drugs, and they'll just go by their word and get warrants off of it. And the judges will, of course, approve the warrants. So you could be one of those people that hasn't done anything wrong, has never done drugs, doesn't have drugs, and, oh, yeah, that guy. And they rip your fucking house apart. And hopefully they don't accidentally kill you in the process because they felt like you didn't comply or you were reaching for something, or when you heard your door being bashed in, which leads to no-knock warrants. One of the things that came out more of, they did this before, but, and I again suggest you read Radley Balco's book, The Rise of the Warrior Cop. But in that, he goes a lot into no-knock raids, where they have a warrant, and because it's drugs, they say that they need to break the door down. They can't announce themselves. Well, I guess maybe while they're breaking the door down, they say police. Or if they don't open right away, they just break the door in because that person could get rid of their drugs. Even though, isn't that the whole point? They wouldn't get the arrest, but they would get rid of the drugs, which isn't that what they were trying to do? So isn't that a positive thing? But no, that's not good enough. They want the arrest there. So they would do these, or not would do, they still do them, no-knock raids, where you could be sleeping and they could be at the wrong address and they could bash your door in. You could grab your gun because you think someone has broken into your house and end up getting killed by the police, or shooting one of them and end up getting prosecuted for killing an officer or shooting an officer when you didn't do anything in the first place. And there have been so many mistakes, not only mistakes where they went to the wrong address, but as I said earlier, where they went to places where there were no drugs. They got their information from crackheads, essentially, or people that, you know, just smoked marijuana once in a while and all they found was residue, and they, you know, broke the whole door down and tore the whole house apart for somebody who doesn't even sell cannabis, just uses it occasionally. So one of the other things that it would do, obviously, is it would decrease the amount of departments in within the police, and police as well, because if they're not going around arresting people for drugs and they're not getting drug calls, I mean, that's probably half of their, you know, I don't know the specifics. I know that 25% of their arrests are for actual serious crimes. They're on the uniform FBI crime list in Las Vegas, and 75% are not. So things like possession of cannabis or minor drugs, minor drug possession would be part of that 75%. So that's who they're going after. So there would be less law enforcement to harass people to do things that weren't necessary. And not only in terms of police, but in terms of federal law enforcement agencies as well, where the DEA would be gone. Because what would you need a DEA for? Now, you could say that about the ATF as well. For some reason, they have an agency that governs over three legal things. They need an armed agency for that. So I'm sure they'd want to keep the DEA, but this is in a, again, a scenario where everything's totally decriminalized and the government has nothing to do with it. So this is more of a ideal situation, not the situations that they're creating now with cannabis, where they're taxing the fuck out of it, they're regulating the fuck out of it. The money part is not as bad as if they're involved in checking things out, meaning they have a whole, you know, like a task force or a agency that deals with it. That is probably, I don't see them not having something like that in the future. I mean, they already have the DEA, so that's why I think they're not doing anything extra, as far as I know, regarding, you know, marijuana agents. But they do have, in some states, they have alcohol agents. It's ridiculous. I think in like North Carolina or North and South Carolina, one of those states, because a girl was arrested. She had taken off because they didn't have a uniform on, and like a guy just like jumped on her car. She didn't even have alcohol. She wasn't even buying alcohol. It was a college student. It was water or some kind of soda in a different bottle. And I think she got charged with something for leaving the scene, but she didn't even know it was members of this. They have a name for it, but some alcohol bureau or something ridiculous like that. And that's what they're doing. Is if you look at the number of federal agencies now compared to like 50 years ago, I bet you that it probably increased by, it at least doubled. It's insane. So, also any other federal agencies that have departments that deal with drugs, like the FBI, you wouldn't have, and I don't know how involved the FBI gets with drugs. I know they do when it comes to, they get involved with drug dealers from other countries, which they shouldn't have anything to do with. And that's another thing. If it was legal here, why would you be getting involved in what's going on in other drug dealers in other countries? And hopefully the U.S., it would force, I think, a lot of these other countries to legalize drugs anyway. Because if they don't, they're creating, I mean, they're doing it anyway. They've created these cartels. They created these kingpins. Instead of having, you know, you don't have Coke and Pepsi having, you know, shooting it out in the street over their brand and their territory. So what you would have is company, probably pharmaceutical companies, unfortunately, would be the ones who would get in there before everybody else, or because they already deal with drugs, they would be the ones to get in there first. But who knows? But it should be open to anybody that wanted to open a drug shop, or just like they open marijuana shops in Colorado. And I have watched a documentary actually on one. And I mean, it's ridiculous the amount they had to pay for their license. I think it was like $100,000 or maybe it was $20,000. I mean, it was in the hundreds of thousands. Sorry, not hundreds of thousands, tens of thousands. It might have been $20,000 or something. It might have been their business as a whole that cost them like $100,000 to set up. I mean, there are so many regulations and permits and all of this stuff. And that's what I think really needs to be avoided. But there, I mean, there's no way that it's going to be. And I think people should just still buy stuff on the black market, to be honest, and avoid paying the fucking tax. And they can't really, I don't know what they can do, because they can't really prove if you get caught with cannabis in Colorado, I don't know how they can prove where you bought it from. Maybe they have a system set up, but like once you break it up or something, and if they had some way to scan it, I mean, you can't scan like a fucking, you know, a plant. If it had a barcode thing on it at first, yes, but once you bought it and got rid of that, you can't prove anything. So if you bought it on the street and did everything, said, fuck this, we're not going to go the government route, we're going to stay black market, or be, I like the word agorism, really, because black market has the sound of it's bad, because I don't think it is bad. And I don't think the majority of drug dealers are not part of cartels. I know people like to think that, because it's like exotic or sexy or some kind of, you know, it's fun to watch on TV. You're not going to see a TV show usually with, you know, just the normal drug dealers that sell a little, you know, sell some drugs here and there, and there's no violence and there's no nothing, because it's boring. They're not going to report it on the news. They're not going to, you know, it's not anything that they give a fuck about. They want to, you know, show the big busts of the cartels or of the big drug dealers with all the guns. And how many times do you really even see that shit? Rarely ever. Not because that they're not going after them, because for the most part, they don't exist. I'm not saying they don't exist at all, but I'm saying that the majority of drug dealers are not part of these big cartels, and especially in the United States. You know, I can't speak for Mexico and South America, where I know they did have some cartels, and I don't know how it was set up down there. But the reason why was, one, of course, all the demand in the U.S., but it being illegal in the U.S. and it being illegal where they were. Because if it was legal where they were, the crime is gone. And that's another thing that decreases people's freedom, is you have people breaking into your house to buy the drugs because they're so expensive, because to get them here, they have to go through all this risk and all of these things. And every time, every place it goes, more money's added onto it. So if you have cocaine coming from Peru, and I saw this in a documentary, it's nothing, the leaf. But then it goes to this place, and then it adds on more money. And then it goes to this place, and it's more money. And then as it goes and gets all the way to the United States, by the time it gets to the United States, it's serious money. But if you take all of that criminality out of it, not only are people safer, which obviously affects people, not so much in the U.S. because even with drugs, people are still pretty safe. As I've said, cartel-wise, there's no, I mean, you don't have any of that really going on. But people are safer in other ways in the product that they're getting, but we'll get to that. But you have companies that come in, legitimate legal companies that are not going to battle it out in the fucking street. And then they sell for a reasonable price. You go in the store and buy them. You know what you're getting. You don't have to worry about somebody trying to rob you or rip you off or anything like that, or steal your money. You go to the store, you buy it, you use it, whatever. As opposed to now, they want to blame in places like Mexico and in South America, they want to blame the criminals when really they should be blaming the governments. And it goes back to the pressure from the United States. Because if the U.S. told them tomorrow to legalize drugs, I'm pretty sure they would, most of these countries. Now, some might tell them to fuck off, but why? Because the government can tax them when they ship them out of the country, and the government can get in on it too. And some of the countries, the communist countries or semi-communist. I mean, the fucking U.S. is a semi-communist country, okay? Just so everybody realizes. Government schools is part of communism. So is a graduated income tax. There are a lot of things that are socialist, at least, about the United States. So along with all of the redistribution of wealth and all of that stuff that is going on. But regardless of that, I mean, these countries could make money off it at the same time. So if the United States said, okay, we're going to decriminalize all drugs, we, you know, meet with all these other countries, do the same thing, I guarantee you that they would as well. You'd have a reduction in crime like that. The crime in the United States related to drugs, I think, is more, and this is just my opinion, I would say more people breaking into your house. And that's something that infringes on your freedom because that's your property. You have people that are breaking into your property and infringing on the rights of your property. So in that sense, that most likely would, I don't think it would 100% go away, but I think it would be reduced by a lot because drugs would be affordable. Now, as it is, you have all these drug companies that are ripping people the fuck off anyway. But when it comes to things that can be grown, I mean, it technically all of these drugs could even be grown in parts of the United States based on their climate, like probably Florida, Southern California, possibly. I don't know if they would be as potent as they would if you're growing them in South America, in the case of cocaine, and Asia when it comes to poppies. And I don't know, in Afghanistan as well. I don't know why poppies would grow, you know, what the climate of Afghanistan is, where they're growing poppies. The other thing is, even though a lot of these drugs are mixed with chemicals, that if they were legal, that the purity would be better. And I mean that in the sense of not to get you more fucked up, but if they're not as pure because, you know, it's too dangerous, they think, you know, they could mix it with something that is legitimate to mix it with, not like they do on the street where you have people who don't know anything about chemistry, you know, cooking all this shit like crystal meth or taking a bunch of fucking chemicals. There's this drug that I saw a video on called Crocodile or something, which is supposed to be like heroin, except it's mostly in Russia and Eastern Europe. And it's, they said U.S., it's the equivalent where $650 worth of heroin was $50 crocodile. And it literally, your skin, like, you get these sores and it goes down to the bone. And because they're dumping a bunch of fucking chemicals in it. And it's because it's illegal that this is happening. So it's the fact that you would get some kind of purity in a positive way is what I'm saying. Not in a sense of that it would be so much stronger. You wouldn't get the shit that they put in it, is what I'm saying. But going back to people breaking into houses and stealing and committing crimes, I mean, that would be cut way down because people could go into stores and get it. What about people that, and that's something that more affects your freedom. This so much doesn't, because this would affect users, but people being able to, well, this affects society in general, that if people are on certain drugs that give them withdrawal, that they wouldn't get the withdrawal because they'd have access to get those drugs and they'd have the money to get those drugs where they could function in society. Now, I guess depending on what it is, I'm sure there's drugs that you can't function in society normally and be addicted to those drugs. But if they were decriminalized, it would be a lot easier to get help and a lot less people would be more apt to get help because they wouldn't worry about getting into any trouble or anything like that. So you'd have that as well. Also, the relationship with the police, I think, would be much improved because you wouldn't have them, people walking down the street, being harassed as much or being searched. Because that's, again, I think the number one thing that people are searched for, no matter what they're doing. If you're walking down the street, they're thinking, well, maybe this person has drugs on them. Yes, weapons is another thing, but I think drugs is the biggest. That, oh, these kids might have drugs on them. And if you listen to a lot of these videos that people record, that's what they're always asking about, drugs. Oh, do you have any drugs on you? Well, if you tell me now, you know, it will be better than if you don't tell me at all. So you have people's freedoms being violated where they're being searched, where there's no right to search them, and they're not even doing anything. You also have the NSA feeding data to the DEA. You have police on, I always forget the name of the thing, a Stingray, Project Stingray, where they're tapping people's phones. You have that as well. And it's not for fucking terrorism. It's you have drug agencies that are illegally tapping people's phones. Now, whether they're dealing drugs or not, you may have them tapping the phones of relatives or friends or, you know, and they're doing these without warrants. Now, not that it really matters because warrants are pretty much rubber stamped anyway, but still, they're violating the Constitution. First of all, and I brought this up before, they're violating the Constitution anyway, and it doesn't really matter with the 9th and 10th Amendments because the 10th Amendment, of course, leaves it up to the states and you have federal drug laws. And they arrest people based on federal drug laws. Not only that, I mean, they're arresting people in other countries for shipping drugs to the United States. That's how crazy it is. At least they were. I was watching the Narcos on Netflix and how they were going after the different cartels in Colombia. And one of the main things was that Pablo Escobar was against was the extradition to the United States because of how bad the jails were, was one of the things that he said. And we'll actually get to jails a little later as well, depending on how much time we have left at that point. But they essentially just violate the Constitution anytime they want anyway. So you have the 9th Amendment, which I've recited. I think I just recited it last week. I don't know if I have my Constitution book so I can read it exactly. I believe I do. I got to find the page here. But essentially it says just because it didn't give you the right doesn't mean you don't have it. So let me find the Bill of Rights here. So they're violating, in my opinion, both the 9th and 10th Amendment with drugs, and they have been since the beginning. The right of the people to be... No, that's not it. I don't know my Roman numerals. I said numericals. The immersion in the Constitution of certain rights... enumeration in the Constitution of certain rights shall not be construed to deny or disparage others retained by the people, meaning that you essentially have rights that are not listed in the Constitution. And I would say as long as you don't directly hurt anybody or damage or hurt their property and respect their freedom, that you have the right to do whatever you want. And that would be include use drugs, excuse me, and put what you want in your body. And as they said, that for 140 years, there were no laws prohibiting what you put in your body. I don't think that was by accident. So I'm going to take a quick break. When we come back, we're going to talk about civil asset forfeiture. And this is something that could affect you. Again, you don't have to be a drug user or a drug dealer for this to affect you at all. And you could lose your business over something like this. We'll also talk about the CPS, how your kids can be taken away, not only for using drugs, but you can have investigations just based on somebody calling, the corruption of the government and how they sold drugs on their own and will arrest you for it, as well as some other things. So we will be back after this, nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. Be sure to check us out and like us on Facebook. You can find all of our social media links at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. You can also find all of our archives at spreaker.com. And our newer archives, I think, have started about a month or two ago. If you're on SoundCloud, as I've been getting a lot of listens recently on, not a lot, but I mean a lot for me, I consider them a lot, on SoundCloud. So thank you, everybody that's been listening on SoundCloud. And just a quick little statistic for everybody, that in 1985, there were 41,000 people in jail for drugs. Now there are 500,000 people in jail for drugs. So I would think about that. So we'll be right back after this. NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com.
The 10th Amendment was sort of taken to be implicit in the Constitution even before it was included with the Bill of Rights. And it simply means that the federal government has only the powers that are delegated to it, and the states and the people retain the remainder. And if you look at the state ratifying conventions where the states decided whether or not to ratify the Constitution, there you see that one after the other, they were being assured that even without the 10th Amendment, the Constitution as drafted already implicitly contained this idea.
I sued the federal government based on the 10th Amendment. And probably the only sheriff in history to ever sue the federal government as a standing sheriff and win a case at the U.S. Supreme Court. And it was all based on the 10th Amendment, state sovereignty. And basically what our case proved is that the federal government is not our boss.
The 9th and 10th Amendment together give us a good guide to constitutional interpretation. The 9th Amendment says that, you know, just because a right is listed in the Bill of Rights does not mean we don't also have other rights. You know, I want to make clear that this is not some kind of a grant of rights. And the Bill of Rights just protects rights that already existed. But they thought that was the most important, because in their recent experience under the abuse of King and Parliament, they had had denial of jury trial, violation of property rights, warrantless searches, the writs of assistance, you know, without probable cause being given to a judge. So they had experienced gun confiscation. All those things they experienced, the whole point of the Bill of Rights was to prevent that from happening again. And they didn't trust the arguments of the Federalists were that no Bill of Rights was necessary because the new Constitution, the new government created by the Constitution, was so weak that it couldn't possibly trample on the rights of the people. That was Hamilton's argument. And the response to that was, we're not going to trust that, you know, limited enumerated grant of power to be enough. We want to have extra guarantees. That's the point of the Bill of Rights. And Hamilton also argued that, well, if you enumerate certain rights, that will make it seem as though other rights are not retained, another argument they gave against the Bill of Rights. That's why the Ninth Amendment is there. Say, just because we list these things we think are really important doesn't mean that other things don't exist, other rights. Our rights are as innumerable as the stars or as grains of sand on the beach.
The states, with the Tenth Amendment, were supposed to balance out the onerous activities and laws of a federal government gone wild. And so the Tenth Amendment is very important in that regard, to start to bring back the balance between the states and the federal government.
In America, we've got a constitution, and the entire constitution is just completely saturated with these principles of state sovereignty. Article 1, Section 3, Article 1, Section 8, Article 2, Section 2, Article 4, Article 5, the Ninth Amendment, the Tenth Amendment, all this has to deal with state sovereignty, making sure that the federal government stays extremely limited so that way we, as individual citizens, can have the most influence over local government so that way we can protect our rights. We don't have to rely on Washington, D.C. to protect our rights if they would just follow the Constitution.
I think of the Tenth Amendment now, it's a relic of our failure. And future historians will look back and they'll see all the things that contributed to the demise of American prosperity, and they will say, but all they had to do was follow the Tenth Amendment.
Hello, ma'am. Can you roll down the window?
Georgia, Telltale.
Can you get it all the way down?
County,
is that as far down as it goes?
Point on what can I do for you,
what's going on?
Can you roll down the window?
Why?
For my safety?
Why?
For my safety, because...
Roll the window all the way down?
Yes, ma'am.
Why?
Because I'm getting ready to have you sign a citation, ma'am, and I'm not ever going to reach into your vehicle.
Okay.
I'm going to ask you one more time to roll down the window, please, ma'am. For unsafe equipment.
Why do you need the window all the way down? I'm talking
for my safety, because I'm going to be putting this...
Right here.
My hand is going to be near the window, ma'am.
It doesn't need
okay, step out of the vehicle. Step out of the vehicle. Step out of the vehicle.
I'm
88,
I
need 44.
Okay,
step out.
Why?
Step out of the vehicle. Open up.
City Nazareth. 10 Park,
adjacent
to. Open the window. If you don't open the window, I'm going to break the window. Ma'am.
The racetrack, four sizes.
She's refusing to open the door or roll down the window.
Open the door.
Open the window.
What did I do?
Roll it down.
It will be broken.
Ma'am, if you do not roll down the window, all the way. Ma'am, I'm recording it also on this camera. I need you to roll down the window all the way. For my, then step out of the vehicle. Step out of the vehicle.
What is the law that I have to have?
The law is that I'm asking, you are detained right now. You are detained right now and you need to get out of the vehicle.
I'm calm. What is the law?
Get out of the vehicle. The law is you are being detained right now because for a traffic infraction. You are being detained for a traffic infraction. Step out of the vehicle. Ma'am, step out of the vehicle. Step out of the vehicle. If you roll it up on my window.
Oh my God, are you serious? I have to go to the doctor.
Get out. Get out of the car right now.
Oh my God.
Get out of the car right now. Get out.
Wait.
Get out of the car. Get out of the vehicle. Down on the ground. Get down on the ground.
Are you serious? You're scraping me.
Down on the ground.
This is not necessary. What did I do? County Patrol 21. What did I do? I asked him a question.
You are about to get resisted.
Why am I resisting? I'm not resisting.
No, you are getting charged with resisting right now. Stand up.
I have to go to the doctor.
88 on 10-15.
Why am I getting
medical? Do you need an ambulance here right now?
Yes, I do.
Okay.
I don't understand this. I asked him why am I being pulled over. He said because
88, I had to break the window. She was rolling it up on my hand. She's advising she's having a miscarriage. If you can call FD.
I asked him what was the citation if the window has to be all the way down. He would not explain to me.
I told you. Said, ma'am, you were being detained.
Did I ask you what law?
For a traffic infraction. I asked you to step out of the vehicle when you refused to roll down the window.
And I asked him why, because he was getting loud when he was getting angry. I asked him why. Why?
That's from me.
Why? Why did I need to?
Why do you think?
Why did you get violent with me?
Ma'am,
why?
I didn't get violent at all.
Why did this happen?
This could have been completely avoided. This could have been avoided.
Out of my car.
You're right.
You grabbed me out of the car. You yanked
You're right.
me out of the car.
You're right, because you wouldn't comply.
No. I was
yes,
in
ma'am.
The car safe. I showed
no,
my hand. Why am I bleeding?
This episode is brought to you by AJ Plus. In a 1971 speech to Congress, President Richard Nixon called drug abuse America's public enemy number one. In the same speech, he declared war on drug addiction, and since then, the war on drugs has been a controversial policy issue for the United States. After four decades, we want to know, did the war on drugs work? Well, in the last 44 years, Nixon's connection between crime and drugs has had far-reaching consequences, particularly in terms of race. Human Rights Watch has reported that in the 70s, African Americans in the U.S. were already being overrepresented in drug arrests, with twice as many arrests as Caucasians. But since the war on drugs began, African Americans have been arrested for drug offenses at five times the rate of white offenders, and yet, on average, Caucasians commit more drug crimes. Part of the reason for this discrepancy has been attributed to unfair drug sentencing laws, specifically targeted toward minorities and the poor. In 1986, President Ronald Reagan signed a bill that authorized the Anti-Drug Abuse Act. This enacted mandatory minimum sentences for convictions concerning a number of drugs, including two forms of cocaine. Crack cocaine, which was cheaper and more commonly used by the lower class, carried a mandatory minimum sentence of 5 years for 5 grams. For the more expensive powdered cocaine, one would need 500 grams for the same sentence. This 100-to-1 disparity, along with other similar drug laws, skyrocketed the number of minority drug arrests. Only in 2010 did President Barack Obama authorize a bill that lessened the gap in drug sentencing. The Drug Policy Alliance reports that annually, the U.S. spends more than $51 billion on the war on drugs, and in 2013 arrested 1.5 million people on nonviolent drug charges. In fact, some estimates place the total amount spent by the federal government on the war on drugs as high as $1 trillion. And yet, addiction rates have been unaffected, drug prices have dropped considerably, and the U.S. has the highest incarceration rates in the world. In 2010, more than half of all federally incarcerated prisoners were serving drug-related sentences. Even the CIA has been implicated in the trafficking of illegal drugs. If our own government can't avoid violating drug laws, how can we be expected to? With marijuana legalization slowly spreading across the U.S. and the success of drug decriminalization in countries like Portugal and Uruguay, it is clear that the war on drugs has failed. The illegal drug trade is a complex and sometimes overwhelming system to understand. To learn what the whole story of an 8-ball of cocaine can look like, check out this video from AJ Plus.
Cocaine, it's a hell of a drug. It's also hella expensive. An 8-ball, an eighth of an ounce or 3.5 grams, costs around $250 in the U.S. But what's the real price of that little baggie?
There's a link to that video also down in the description. Thank you for watching Test Tube. Please subscribe. We appreciate your support.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. Call in at 702-470-7664 or Skype in. Username, Nonpartisan Liberty for All.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. And we are back. If you'd like to call in, 702-470-7664 is the number. And if you'd like to Skype in, it's Nonpartisan Liberty, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All. And I'm sorry, I'm trying to look at like texts at the same time. Username Nonpartisan Liberty for All. Just send a contact request and what you'd like to talk about and your name, and we'll bring you on. So I played a couple clips during the break. One I had actually played on Friday because it really disturbs me. This has been going on all over the country. People's windows getting broken because they won't get out of their car during during traffic. What would you call it? There's a word I'm looking for. I hate that. That happens to me so much on the air now that I'm looking for a word and I can't think of it, whether it's me getting nervous for a minute or it's just that I'm tired because I get up at 5:45 every morning. Traffic stops. I knew it had the word traffic in it. And, you know, it's fucked up. After doing the show for 2 years now, a little over 2 years, I do sometimes get nervous. And I'm usually pretty prepared now. It's just, I don't know, you know, I put together an outline and try to do as much research as I can, which unfortunately is not as much as I'd like. But it, yeah, sometimes I actually still get nervous when I'm on the air because I want to do the best show possible. I really want to bring something that is entertaining as well as informative. And I have my nights where I'm off and I have my nights where I'm more entertaining than, not than informative, but I guess sometimes I'm more informative than entertaining. But I like to have a balance. I like to make sure that you get entertained, and that you get informed at the same time. And that's really my goal with the show. I mean, one of my goals is to entertain and inform people. And you don't necessarily have to agree with me or everything I say or anything I say for that matter. If you listen to the show and you're one of those people, because I used to do this. I'm not doing it as much anymore. But I would listen. I was talking about this, how there's certain people I stopped listening to because they would just get me mad. But I would listen to a lot of shows that I didn't like them. I didn't like the host. I totally disagreed with them. And that's why I listened, because when it came to Sirius Progressive, which I talked about before, I did it because I felt like I was getting insight into what their agenda, the progressive agenda was. And it's some scary fucking shit. Don't get me wrong. The conservative agenda and the Republican agenda, which I think they might say that they're two different things now, but they're equally, I think, scary. Although I think the progressive agenda is a little scarier, but they both want to rule over you. And that's the problem. It's just how they want to rule over you. But there's some people I can't stand. And I had stopped listening to them. And what I did was I would listen and like yell at my radio and fucking talk to it if I was in my car alone or whatnot. And that would go on occasionally. So it really, I understand, and I'm trying to text at the same time, so that's why I'm sounding like I'm off. But I understand if people listen that don't agree with me, and I don't care. You know, a listener is a listener, and there may be a time that they start to maybe agree with some things, or because I'm not that type of conservative or progressive show that just says the same shit that all the other shows say. And what I say is based in fact. You know, it's not based in, you know, in bullshit. And I actually believe in what I'm saying, and I have a goal, and I'm into what I'm doing, obviously, because all these other people are getting paid, some of them millions, for what they do, and they're getting millions of listeners when I'm getting, you know, barely any. In comparison to them, I'm, you know, 0.5% or something. And so you have to be very dedicated. So hopefully, even for the I'm trying to look at my text and see if I wrote it right. And I didn't. And I talked about how I'm great at multitasking, but I'm not great at multitasking this. So what I was saying is that, you know, so even people that totally disagree with me and yell that they think I'm stupid. And I had somebody on Facebook who I knew from years ago from Boston who said I was crazy because I thought heroin should be legal. You know, these are the types of attitudes. And you look at, where does that attitude come from? I don't think this person ever did heroin. If they did, they probably only sniffed it. I know they hung around with people who have tried it. But I'm trying to do my show at the same time as texting this person. But so the people that do feel that way, you know, you never know when they can hear something. Oh, sorry, I was talking about the person with heroin. I don't know how they came to that conclusion, but obviously they weren't open-minded, and I think there's some people that are just totally lost, but that's not necessarily the truth. People can, something can happen, I think, when it comes to what I'm doing. I think that you can change your mind about things, because what I feel is that I'm just putting the truth out there, that it's not a conservative spin or Republican or Democrat or progressive, and that I have a party agenda or anything like that. If you want to say I have an agenda, which I wouldn't even consider it, that is, I want everybody to be able to live their own life and be free. I don't have an agenda as far as how you live your life. As long as you don't hurt anybody else or their property. So, as long as you don't do that, I have no problem with how you live your life. That's your personal choice. And that's the whole point, is these other people want to tell you how to live your life, and they want to tell you what's right and wrong and those type of things. I, for the most part, don't want to do that. I mean, I do want to, I will say something's wrong. If you're trying to tell me how to live my life, I think that's wrong. But people are so brainwashed by what's gone on can't break out of that. And I'm sorry, I apologize for the past couple minutes where I just text emergency, where I'm trying to multitask. And maybe the more I do that, the better I'll get at it. But I don't want to make it a habit because I suck when I'm trying to talk on the radio. And then that's where people will say, oh, you talk slow and you can't even think and whatever. But people have been so brainwashed, especially when it comes to drugs. But hopefully people will hear some of this stuff. I mean, you have cops that, former cops that now say that they don't believe in the drug war anymore and they were into it the whole time. So people can change. It's just what is it going to be that changes them? And that's why I cover a lot of different things. But when is someone going to realize that they don't have any freedom, that they really don't? What is it going to take to make them realize that and realize the truth about things? Now, maybe they never will, and maybe they don't want freedom. And maybe they're the type of person that totally believes in a socialist society and they want to be controlled and they want things to be distributed by the government. But I think even with those people that might be yelling, if they're listening, and maybe they're not listening, you know, maybe that type of audience doesn't listen, and I don't know, but that they will potentially realize what I'm trying to do and change their mind about some things, maybe, even on a small level. And then again, maybe not. So anyway, I apologize for texting while I'm doing the show. I try to avoid that. But that definitely throws me off. So I was talking about different freedoms that are being taken away. And the one I said I was going to get to before the break or after the break is this civil asset forfeiture. Now, the reason they use for this, they use two reasons, of course, is terrorism is one of them because, you know, you could be a terrorist. And drugs. They're starting to go back to drugs as a backup now. Like after 9/11, a lot of the stuff was, well, you could be a terrorist. And they'd use the terrorist thing, and that would be their main reason. But now it seems that their main thing is... Excuse me, had a swallow there. Their main thing is drugs. Like they're going back to drugs. And yes, you could be a terrorist too. So with civil asset forfeiture, this can affect anybody. It has to do with the one that is happening a lot now. And this is happening, you know, we hear about stories here and there, but I mean, that's not the only time it happens. It happens all the time. It probably happens every day. They're taking the charging people with targeting, but they're not really charging and targeting their deposits into banks. So meaning that if you deposit $10,000 or more, I guess the bank has to declare a form or you have to, or both. It's something that has to be filed with the government. And I say take all your money out of your bank account so that much never gets deposited in the first place, unless, I guess, you get direct deposit and make more than $10,000 or something. I did actually get a big bonus that was not $10,000, but it wasn't far from it. So it was far enough. But so something like that. But I mean, that was before taxes. So after taxes, it wasn't that anywhere near $10,000. But point being that I guess you could get a check from, you know, these people that are, you know, executives might be making $10,000 per check or whatever, and they're having it direct deposited. I don't know how that works. If your payroll check is over $10,000. But anyway, I would take all your money out of the fucking bank. I wouldn't take it out like $10,000 at a time, but I would, if you have that much money, but I wouldn't keep your money in a bank. And there's nothing illegal about that. I'm just saying I wouldn't keep your money in a bank because they have bank bail-ins and could end up keeping your money or keeping a percentage of your money. And you don't want that to happen. You don't want to be one of the people whose money gets taken by the federal government or by just the bank itself instead of the federal government. So there's no purpose to having your money in a savings account anyway. You know, checking, I understand I have money in a checking account and I use it to pay my bills that way, where I do everything online, but they still wire money or whatnot. So I keep money to pay my bills. But right now I really don't have that much money anyway, so it doesn't really make a difference. But if I had a certain amount of money, I would not keep it in a bank. I would get a safe deposit box at a safe deposit box place that specializes in safe deposit boxes, preferably anonymous sales deposit boxes, not a one at a bank that can be taken that way. So anyway, with civil asset forfeiture, if they suspect you are targeting your deposits, so you don't have to fill out the form and declare it with the government, which is so fucked up. Anyway, it's none of their business how much money you have. And what does this go back to? Drugs. What is tracking money and making sure that if you take out a certain amount of money, it's reported to the government? If you deposit a certain amount of money, it's the government. Now, you could say, well, yeah, it's also tax purposes. And that's true. Tax purposes do factor into it as well. But mostly, a lot of it is because you could be using it for drugs. So if you're charged with structuring deposits where you're purposely not putting it, you're putting in less than $10,000 on purpose for your business, even if you're not doing that, they can take your money without charging you with anything because you could be a drug dealer. And that's their rationale and that's their reason. So you have to hire a lawyer. A lot of times it's going to cost you more for a lawyer than the money that was taken. And they know that. So really what they're doing is it's arm rob. I mean, it really is arm robbery, because just because they didn't pull out a gun, you know that they're backed by guns. So if you try to get your money back by just taking it, You know, what are you going to do? Go to the bank and say, give me my money and pull out a gun? So essentially, it's armed robbery as far as I'm concerned. And that's a huge one. And again, a lot of that goes back to drugs being illegal. And these are people that don't even do drugs, but it affects them. You also have the CPS. People can have their kids taken away for smoking marijuana. Now, people can also make false accusations. If people make false accusations, they follow up on them anyway. So somebody who doesn't like you or somebody who thinks they smell marijuana coming from your door, or maybe you have a friend over who smokes marijuana and you don't even know or whatever, they go smoke it outside. And they decide to call the CPS. Now, they might not be able to take your kids away, but you're still going to have to deal with them. They'll bring police to your door. They're an agency that, I mean, that's a whole nother story, but they're an agency that is out of fucking control, and there's no due process. There's no, you know, it's another one of those government agencies, and nobody wants to speak out about them or really touch them. Because, oh, they protect kids, but they really don't protect kids. They actually do more damage. They do more harm than good. The government itself, and this is where it's all fucked up, because the government itself has been involved in drug dealing and corruption. You look at the increase in Afghanistan in the exports of opiates since the U.S. government came in, the Iran-Contra, Ricky Ross, who was being supplied by the federal government to fill L.A. with crack. There's international meetings with the DEA where they're getting with all these other countries, as I was saying, to stop the flow of drugs and to stop to help with these other countries to ban drugs in their countries as well. You also have the seizure of when they arrest people for drugs. And a lot of the stuff that they may be arresting them for may have nothing to do with drug money, but it doesn't matter. And then they split it with the local police. So local police have an incentive to go after you. And you could have a huge, huge farm where you grow crops, and you have, and this actually happened, have a marijuana plant, like one growing there, and they can take your whole farm. And there was, this was actually in the book, Radley Bilko's book, Rise of the Warrior Crop. And they, instead of him getting arrested, he settled and gave up his farm. You also have, of course, family and friends that are nonviolent drug users that could end up in prison and might be in prison right now. You have the jail budgets, the tax money that you're paying to jails, the amount of jail population. I mean, they could stop building jails. They could probably close down a whole bunch of jails. I believe it's 50% of the people in jail are in there for drug-related crimes. You could close half the jails. You also have, because drugs are illegal and people want to get high off of something, you have drug houses, I don't think they would call them that, but like you have meth labs, you have, when I first moved here, some kid tried to tell me he ran a couple meth labs here, and maybe he did, or he used to, and the chemicals being used, I mean, it could be in your own neighborhood, which wouldn't happen, obviously, if they're legal. Now, from what I understand, most meth now is coming from Mexico, because it's better, I guess. and made better, but you know, they can make it here as well if they're stopping the supply from Mexico. So when it comes to all of these things that affect your freedom that are related to drugs, you don't have to be a drug user or really have anything to do with drugs for a lot of these things to affect you at all. It's the whole culture is being affected by the fact that drugs are illegal. And I think in a negative way. Now, I'm not saying that drugs are a good thing and everybody should go out and get fucked up and everybody should go out and do drugs. I'm not saying that at all. What I am saying is that the positives, and again, plenty of ex-police that were drug, you know, DEA, that were part of the narcotics department and the police department will tell you this, that the drug war is a failure. And what I'm telling you is that the drug war not only takes away people's freedom and what they can do with their body and kidnaps them off the street for deciding to use a certain substance. It not only does that, but it affects society in so many other ways that have nothing to do with using drugs themselves. Now, of course, when it comes to users, as I mentioned earlier, it would be cheaper and safer. You could sell it at drug stores. You wouldn't have to worry about getting robbed or killed when you're buying them. You could get more honest information from pharmacists and not bullshit, which you can pretty much get on the internet anyway, but they'd be produced by companies that know what they're doing, that you could actually sue if you needed to. Well, that's if you had a government, but even if you didn't, there's ways that there would be arbitration and things like that. You wouldn't have to worry about getting arrested, and you wouldn't have to worry about getting in any trouble trying to get help or worrying about getting help. I think a lot of people, because it's illegal, they think they'd get fired from their job, or they are not as quick to get help because it's illegal. And then they feel like they're going to be marked from that. Which you're pretty much going to be marked if you know, for alcohol too, even though it's legal, because they're tracking, you know, everything you do. But at least it's not something that's illegal. And it will eliminate these drugs that are being made by people that are not chemists, that they're putting all these chemicals in and all this shit. And if you had it being made by pharmaceutical companies, or at least companies on the level of a pharmaceutical company, I don't know that, you know, pharmaceutical companies wouldn't make that much money off it anyway, but because everything, they wouldn't have any patents on it or anything like that. But at least it would be made by companies where they're reputable and you know what you're getting, as opposed to, again, things just being cut up with whatever. And when it comes to crime, of course, this is something that affects everybody as well. Although, again, in the U.S., it's really just more break-ins and things like that, robberies, but it could be armed robberies. And as I mentioned, you have LEAP, Law Enforcement Against Prohibition. Of course, Joe Arpaio in Phoenix, who I can't stand, still supports drugs being illegal and likes to humiliate people in jail for drugs. But crime would be pretty much eliminated. The crime associated with drugs, at least, would pretty much be eliminated if drugs were decriminalized. And the robberies would go way down. You'd still have people doing robberies just to get money for they want to go buy shit. But people breaking into houses and doing a lot of that stuff would go way down. So you'd have so many positives. Drug mules, where they were, I don't know if they're still using them, but there were a lot of accidental deaths from drug mules where it bursts in their stomach. That is obviously not safe. That would be eliminated. And the violation of the government's own laws, their own constitutional amendments, the 9th and 10th Amendment, would be no longer violated. Well, at least not when it comes to drugs. They violate the 10th Amendment and the 9th Amendment in other ways anyway. They do whatever they want to do, and we know that. Just to go through the prison stats real quick, and then we'll wrap it up here. There are 100, and this is 2013 stats, 716 per 100,000. We have 22, or in the U.S., there's 22% of the world's prison population. That was in 2013. At the height, it was 25 in 2008. But the U.S. is only 4% of the world's population. It's been increasing since about 1940. I just looked at a graph of it going up, and it peaked at 2008, where it was 24.7. So it's went down a little, but not much. And no country really compares to the U.S. except Russia, which I believe in 2008 was 455 per 100,000, and that's still almost 300 less. And the U.S. also keeps their prisoners in longer. That's one of the reasons why they have three strike laws as well. And, of course, there's the private prison industry. And as I mentioned earlier, there's a difference between the private prison industry and tax money going towards it and something being outsourced. Private prisons are not private. They're just outsourced is what it is. The U.S. government is taking the money that would go to a government prison and they're giving it to a private prison. That's the only difference. It's called outsourcing. It's not private. Now, I support privatization, which means you don't pay taxes towards something. People pay for what they want. Not necessarily in the prison industry. There's different ways to handle that in a free society, but there would only be people going to prison that actually were violent criminals that should be in prison. Just a quick note about prison. I mean, prison is bad enough to take away your freedom, but it is so fucked up and how bad it is. And nobody seems to care because they feel like everyone that's in there deserves to be in there. And with 50% of the people in there because of drugs, obviously that is not the case. A cop had even said it's easy to arrest somebody for drugs. You know, they get an arrest and less paperwork. And that was said by a former cop. And just real briefly, the statistics. In 1985, I mentioned this earlier, 41,000 in jail because of drugs. Now it's 500,000 in 2010. 31 million arrested on drug-related charges. As of September 2014, over 50% of the people in jail are because of drugs or drug-related crimes, and almost 4 million on probation due to drug-related crimes. And, of course, nicotine and alcohol kill way more people, especially nicotine and tobacco. Cigarettes, of course, kill a lot more people. So that's about all we have for tonight. I'd like to thank everybody, especially those who tuned in early. I know that was kind of last minute. I did post it last night, but I had a lot of information and I still wanted to make sure I ended the show on time, as I got to make sure I get enough sleep to get to work on time. Not that I don't get to work on time. I just end up getting there tired. So thanks everybody for tuning in. Tomorrow we will be joined by Katie Reyes, and we plan on talking about government agencies. So it kind of relates a little to tonight's show, but that may change. But that's what the plan is as of now. But either way, Katie will be joining us, so be sure to tune in tomorrow. Be sure to check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. And thanks, everybody, for tuning in. I really appreciate it. Please like us on Facebook and all our other social media, which you can find at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. Thanks, everybody.
But at the end of the day, each and every man should go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers.